Thank you, chairpersons, audience. So this is also in challenging areas. That is, this session was on crosstalk. So what do you mean by crosstalk? I mean there is a dilemma on what we do. So when you see a patient with chronic kidney disease, we have a therapeutic nihilism that nothing will be useful in this patient. This patient is going to die. That's the biggest problem. And that concept is there with us, with the physician and the society both. Now, with this background, when we are going to talk, we have to first know what is the pathophysiology of this problem, a coronary artery disease special for kidney disease. So what has been shown that there will be a variety of definition of GFR calculations by nephrology society, by physician societies, by many bodies. What I am going to show you is the latest one, which has been published from American Journal of Cardiology, October this year. And this is that above 60 ml per minute of 1.73 meter square of body surface, which is easier to calculate with your smartphone, the renal function we say is normal. And below 15, it's a severe renal dysfunction. Now from 15 to 16, these are the age group. This is the kidney problems group, which we mostly encounter. And remember one thing, just don't look at the creatinine value itself. Creatinine of 1.2 at 80 kilo body weight patient who is 40 years has not significant. In the contrary, he is an 80 years old fellow who is a 50 kg weight, and 1.2 creatinine signifies severe renal dysfunction. So you need to understand not the creatinine, but the creatinine clearance or the GFR. The more important thing is the symptoms of this patient with coronary artery disease is underrepresented because they usually present with dyspnea. And dyspnea acute onset may be a manifestation of acute coronary syndrome. No chest pain. Now, if a patient with chronic kidney disease comes with dyspnea, you will feel that it may be due to volume overload, it may be due to anemia, it may be due to hypertensive heart failure. So you will not think of coronary artery disease at the beginning. And this is the fact that the patient mostly with chronic kidney disease present with non-ST myocardial infarction rather than ST elevated myocardial infarction because of the various reasons. The most important thing is the supply-demand mismatch because they have a hypertension, left ventricular hypertrophy, ischemic preconditioning is there, there may be collateralization of the blood pressure, and the most important thing is because of ECG changes in the echocardiographic, because of left ventricular hypertrophy, you may not be able to understand what is happening. Now, what is the evidence and guideline? The evidence, you need to understand that we have some limited knowledge of CKD and CAD. So what we know till now scientifically are this, which is, you don't have the marker, huh? Which is seen in this first part of the site. So what is important that CKD and CAD, can you fit into that screen? It I, chulche? Achha, achha, achha. Dekhte bachche na bodhay. Oh, na, 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 eater. মাঝখানটা লাইটটা কোনটা লাইটটা তো উপরেরটাই হওয়া উচিত সেটা দিয়ে তো হচ্ছে না সো ওকে 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 ফাইন সো হোয়াট ইজ ইম্পর্টেন্ট টু নো দ্যাট আনটিল অ্যান্ড আনলেস ইউ হ্যাভ থ্রি ভেসেল ডিজিজ লেফট ভেন ডিজিজ অর এ প্রক্সিমাল এলইডি ডিজিজ there is no survival benefit, so probably it is all for CKD and non-CKD. In patient with non-ST elevation MI, early invasive strategy, if refractory angina hemodynamic stability without comorbidity, such as CKD is there, the indication is very clear. Whenever there is a CKD, despite all this problem, that is non-ST elevation MI with a acute hemodynamic instability, even if you do something, the outcome may be question mark. But one thing is very clear, that you need to do intervention in patient with ST elevation MI. So my message to you is that what we know that if a patient has a myocardial infarction who is even on dialysis, don't say that angioplasty cannot be done. If it is ST elevation MI, you should send him for angioplasty. That is very clear. And other areas are gray zone. You have to discuss with the patients what they do. In stable CKD, what is not known, that value of invasive strategy at the beginning, we do not know. We do not know the individual therapy based at risk and benefit, and the patient preference is more important. Even the future direction should be on this CKD specific trial of OMT. Like when you think about coronary artery disease management, you talk about maximum dose of statin. The moment you think about chronic kidney disease and CAD, you think that statin may not be, high dose may not be good for the kidney, so you wanted to give low dose. And the triglyceride is high, you cannot give fenofibrate. The second thing is that if the creatinine is increasing, you cannot give ARB. So this thing has not been discussed in any trial, that what you should give as an antihypertensive therapy in this patient. So these are the future direction. So actually our knowledge specific to kidney disease and coronary artery disease is limited, because all these patients have been excluded from the clinical trial. But in countries like Japan, they have shown that even in patients with CKD, if you do a, this is a Japanese study, if you do a primary angioplasty, what happens? That happens that the low is the kidney function, the survival is equally low. But if the kidney function is acceptable, the survival is good. So you have to discuss with the patient before you take them for a procedure. Even what has been shown in this registry population, that even in ST elevation MI, non-ST elevation MI, intervention is useful. Now, as an operator, when you send the patient for invasive therapy, you are always concerned that if the kidney goes down, what we'll do. So what I do, or we do as an interventionist, is that we limit the contrast volume. And we wanted to avoid repetitive intra-arterial contrast injection. So please tell your patient, if they are coming for an angiogram, they should be prepared with the intervention if required. Just doing a diagnostic angiogram is of no value. Second, whoever is the patient with a ST elevation myocardial infarction, the chances of kidney injury is very high. The third most important thing is, even intravenous saline, sodium bicarbonate, N-acetylcysteine has not been shown to prevent a contrast-induced acute injury and a survival benefit. So that's why we give only normal saline, not anything else, but N-acetylcysteine or sodium bicarbonate has not been found to be useful in preventing the complications of kidney disease. There is an algorithm. The algorithm is that we used to have non-ionic contrast with a low osmolarity. Isoosmolarity may be better, but the problem is the visualization of the arteries may not be that good, particularly if the patient is anemic and if the patient is having a significant body weight. So we prefer mostly this group of contrast agent. And there is some algorithm, that is, if the patient is female, the chances of contrast-induced nephropathy is more. So that's the reason they are undertreated. If the volume of contrast you give in relation with the creatinine clearance, that has a significant effect on the kidney problems. So if you have a renal dysfunction, you have to limit your contrast. And a PCI to Lehtman is a very important and challenging areas for intervention cardiologist is associated with increased renal injury. Remember, the same patients, if they go for bypass surgery, they also go for dialysis. That is the reason worldwide it is not like that, that bypass surgery is better and angioplasty is inferior. There is some data that rosuvastatin in high dose may prevent a renal injury after a intervention. Vascular complication is also high in these patients, remember. So we prefer to have radial artery access, but there are controversies on this. The people think that if the radial artery is spoiled, future fistula in the forearm is not possible. But we have discussed with many nephrologists, they say that no, still we prefer that because it decreases the chances of bleeding and decreases the chances of peripheral complications. Now what we do, this is published in NEJM this year, last month. So if you have a high risk of patients who can develop a contrast-induced nephropathy, use low osmolality or isosmolality contrast media, minimize contrast volume, that we all do, suspend nephrotoxic medications, particularly metformin is one of the things. It is not nephrotoxic, but the thing is that if you develop contrast-induced nephropathy, the chances of lactic acidosis is very high, which has a high mortality. And hydrate liberally. This is most important. So low risk, there is nothing, but importantly, we treat all the patients at high risk of developing contrast-induced nephropathy, particularly if the patient is diabetic, hypertensive, and a borderline renal function. As an individual, these are the things which, as a cardiologist, all do, is that we try to limit our contrast volume, ultra-low use of contrast with a other imaging mortality, like intravascular ultrasound. OCT is not among that. OCT, you need to give a contrast. And in some of the cases where you find multiple vessel disease, as Dr. Devashish Ghosh said, that you can do a FFR and actually limit the number of stent and number of contrast, volume of contrast, it will be good for the patients. So this complex and high risk procedure for indicated patients are the challenges, and we are ready to accept this challenge if you send the patients to us. To conclude, I give you a case scenario. This is a patient who is simple, because this patient is already in CKD stage 5. He has a pleural effusion and gets symptomatic breathing difficulty after dialysis. Hemoglobin reasonable, ejection fraction good. Now, why you think that this patient needs an angiogram? Because this is the ECG which at resting condition, when the patient was having chest discomfort, not chest discomfort, dyspnea, this is the ECG changes, which shows a significant ST depressions. So this indicates that you need to do something because there is a dynamic STD changes. So what we did a coronary angiogram and we found that there is a left main disease, right coronary artery, we did a fractional flow reserve, which was normal, so we didn't do anything. But left main, left anterior descending artery and this diagonal was diseased. So we tried to do a revascularization. And you can see in this view, the LAD has been nicely made. Left main stent to LAD has been put. And at the 83 years, that is 85 years, 2 years after the follow-up, the patient didn't have any further hospitalization, and the patient is in functional class 2. So we need to understand before I conclude that intervention in CKD is not impossible. Don't keep a nihilistic attitude or negative attitude to this patient that nothing is useful. But the case selection is to be very selective. You need to objectively prove the evidence of ischemia, and it has to be done by experienced operator who can do it smartly. Thank you for your attention.
So thank you, Dr. Banerjee, for covering the subject very nicely. One or two questions from the audience.
Please.
Sir, one question from my side.
Yes.
In my hospital, the nephrologist, whenever the patient comes and these things, if the creatinine is 1.5 or just 1.6, they try to threaten the residents admit the patient in the nephrology department because it is a CKD patient. Okay. In such type of patients, is it mandatory to give the N-acetylcysteine and these things to reduce the creatinine level and go for the further investigations?
Yeah, N-acetylcysteine if you give, actually it decreases the creatinine value by some biological mechanism. So I will request you to go through this NEJM update on contrast-induced nephropathy. What has been shown that even if you develop rise in creatinine after a procedure, it may be a marker of adverse event of heart-related problem rather than the contrast-related problem. Now the thing is that there is no harm in giving N-acetylcysteine. You will be still giving it. But the medico-legally, if you don't give, you are not unsafe. The thing is that these molecules also doesn't taste good, produces nausea, you need to give a lot of volume for that. So why don't you give just normal saline? This is the thing. And this conflict between the nephrologist and the physician and cardiologist will be always there. So a logistic approach will be you have to get them a referral and go ahead with the things. Now, if this patient with a 1.5 creatinine has a ST elevation MI, you need to take them into the lab. The more the delay, the more is the problem. If we can wait, definitely we will wait and try to evaluate. But it's not like that you do it at the cost of a patient safety, because the ejection fraction comes down after a myocardial infarction. The kidney is going to be further down.
Actually, absolutely right. We often have a patient with ST elevation MI who's hemodynamically very unstable. When he comes and you do the first creatinine, which is 1.7, you revascularize that patient, 3 days later it will be 1.3.
Yeah, that's we have seen many of them. Absolutely.
Uncommon experience.
So that we are getting regularly, so that is the question. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.